Now the next speaker, and this will be a highlight, another highlight of this day, actually will talk even more about the future and probably even in more radical terms about the future. We are thrilled to welcome Bruce Sterling here today. He's a science fiction author. He has won many awards for his writing. He has worked on very fascinating projects. He's kind of one of the founding fathers of the cyberpunk movement. And he will focus today in his high-level keynote on the media side of our topic, looking at cyberspace. Not sure whether this term is still adequate today or not, and think with us and present and share his vision about the future of media. What does media mean in this new, highly digitally networked environment? Bruce Sterling, thanks so much for being with us.
Good morning. So yes, that was all true. I am Bruce Sterling, and I'm a science fiction writer. So I was thrilled to have the opportunity to come address a group whose meeting was used the term cyberspace. And I'd like to start by describing my own relationship to that word. Back in the year 1982 was the first time when I saw the word cyberspace. And it arrived in my home in Austin, Texas, in a manila mailing envelope from Vancouver, which had a Xerox of a manuscript produced by a manual typewriter. And the word cyberspace was in this manuscript from this manual typewriter. It was a short story by a writer named William Gibson, whom I scarcely knew at the time, but we had friends in common. So in our little republic of letters, my colleague, Mr. Gibson, was sending me this manuscript for a short story of his. And the story was titled Burning Chrome. And the first time this word cyberspace appears in the story, it's actually part of a commercial brand name. It's a brand name for a future computer, which is being used by one of the protagonists in the story. And this computer is called the Ono Sendai Cyberspace 7. That's what these future hackers are using. They're using a device called the Ono Sendai Cyberspace 7, which is owned, obviously, by a Japanese corporation named Ono Sendai. So cyberspace first appears as part of a commercial brand name. Later, during the heyday of virtual reality in the middle 1980s, a virtual reality entrepreneur tried to trademark the word cyberspace for his own device. It's like, I've made a cyberspace and I own it and this is my trademark. And William Gibson, to his credit, offered to sue. I mean, he hired a lawyer and he went to the trade and patents office and said, you know, look, can this guy simply steal my word cyberspace? He went to the trouble to keep the word cyberspace as part of normal language, you know, in the public domain. And that's why you are now able to use the word cyberspace as a name for your group and your meeting. Because if it had been owned by someone else in the 1980s, it would almost certainly have vanished long ago. It would have been restricted to commercial and trade use, and you would never be able to use that word. Now, among the innovations in this story of William Gibson's was a sentence which became very famous, "The street finds its own uses for things." And the the dictum, or the phrase, the street finds its own uses for things, became part of what you might call a cyberpunk philosophy of technological development. And what does it mean? Well, it means that when you introduce some technical innovation, you cannot really outguess its development very effectively because there are too many actors involved in it, about too many ethical, legal, and social implications, too many people finding too many ways to deploy it. It cannot really be policed. About the one thing you can do is what William Gibson did, which is to attempt to prevent it from being commercially tucked into a corner somewhere or it vanishes. So, what happened to the word cyberspace? Well, this story of William Gibson's first appeared back in 1982 in a magazine, which is now extinct. So the magazine is dead. And the manual typewriter that William Gibson used to write the story is also a dead technology. And it's 28 years later, and the latest development we have in cyberspace is this badge. This badge, which is the only slide I have for my entire speech. But I think it's a pretty good slide because I think it's sort of full of moral and technical and social lessons. This is the future of cyberspace as seen from the year 1982. In 2010, 1982. If I were to go back in time and tell my colleague William what had become of this, it would be a very cyberpunk-style story of the street finding its own unpredictable uses for techno-social innovations. So what is this badge? Well, this badge belongs to the United States Air Force. There are actually three versions of this badge. This is the Cyberspace Operators Badge, and it's worn currently by 30,000 troops. 30,000 troops in the United States Air Force Cyberspace Corps. And there are actually three versions of this badge. It's like the Journeyman's Badge and the Master Badge and the sort of Super Master Cyber War Operator Badge. So it's a military device which is being used by genuine members of the American military. Now, you might say that it's sort of bitterly ironic that this work of William Gibson's, which is, you know, very cyberpunk and very bohemian and concerned mostly with computer crime, has become this shining logo. A very interesting logo, by the way. I think it graphically, I quite like it. There's something very Italian futuristy about this badge. It's very Marinetti, and it's got a lot of abstract dynamism in it. What it really looks like is like Marinetti aerofuturism from the 1930s, where he became obsessed with flight and speed and electricity. I mean, if you were to show this badge to Marinetti and his friends in the 1930s, they would not be surprised by it at all. It really looks like the kind of graphic design Italian futurists liked some 80 years ago. But there are nevertheless 30,000 young men wearing this, and these are your NATO allies. Now, why is it that the word cyberspace found a patron, really, in the United States Air Force? Well, it's a complicated story, but I think I need to tell it to you because these stories are, in fact, complicated. And this demonstrates how difficult it is to outguess the street finding its own uses for things. So, in the United States, there are basically two major players in computer security at the federal level. And one is the National Security Agency. And the second is the military. Now, there's supposed to be a third player, the Department of Homeland Security. But the Department of Homeland Security is so poorly organized that they consistently lose all their political struggles. So the police are basically been sidelined, the civilian police, and the struggle is between an espionage apparatus and the military. Now, why does the military prefer the word cyberspace? It's basically for funding reasons. But it's also, it's a paradigm that they can use to defeat the spies. Now, if you describe cyberspace as electronic transmissions, as signals, as flows of data, as international movements of ones and zeros, of things going on cables, and so forth, clearly the National Security Agency, who are electronic eavesdroppers, they are basically the planet's wiretappers, clearly that kind of activity belongs to them by right because they spy on electronic signals. I mean, that's what they do. They've been doing it since they won the Second World War by breaking the Enigma code, and they do it with Echelon, and they do it with listening devices of all kinds, and you know, they're a very, very secret group, but they're one of the most public secret groups in the world. I mean, you can meet the NSA. They have a great deal of clout within Washington. They are shy people. They're not very worldly. For instance, they're never allowed to travel outside the United States. So they're oddly, I mean, there are jokes about them. You know, they say in the National Security Agency that an extrovert is someone who looks at your shoes instead of his own. But they are shy and geeky in that way, and deliberately so. I mean, the people in the National Security Agency in the United States are spies, and no one is supposed to know that they work for the National Security Agency, so they're very humble and geeky. But then there's the military, who are very concerned about attacks on American systems, and they also have a very large budget, and they're very brusque, and they don't want to passively surrender political control over this very important aspect of modern life to a group of unaccountable, completely non-transparent, opaque spies. So from their point of view, the word cyberspace is super important because space can be defended. You can use a term like American cyberspace, and a congressman can almost understand that. Whereas if you say, you know, the American internet, that really doesn't make very much sense, or American TCP/IP switching protocols, that you know, is obviously an oxymoron, it just doesn't work. So, you know, you need space because you need the idea of a defensible space, of something that can be held, that can be made into a fortress, that can be attacked, that can be defended. So that's what they did, and that's why this cyberspace badge existed. I mean, basically, the young men who wear this badge are doing the same work as the people at the NSA. But rather than simply spying on signals, they are being trained to defend systems from attacks and also to attack computers in other countries or in other regions. And the number one area where this is being done, NATO, is a NATO research center in Estonia, which is NATO's biggest electronic warfare unit. One of the founders of this unit defected to the Russians recently. He was a Russian spy all along. It's a very 1980s story. It's quite fascinating. I could go on and on and on about it. But what I'm trying to get across here is the nature of unintended consequences over a long-term period. Because this really is the true factual future of William Gibson's idea from 1982. And it doesn't matter what William Gibson says about it. He's not the Pentagon, okay? I mean, that political battle is fought on a completely different realm. They don't care where the idea came from. They're using it in a subterranean power struggle that involves billions of dollars. That was the future of real cyberspace. Now, you know, you could say that, okay, this is an unusual story, and it's, well, that's something odd that goes on in the United States. Well, I would refer you to this sheet of paper that all of you got in your little plastic device, which is, why do I have to show my passport to get internet access in Italy? Okay, this is the same phenomenon, basically. I mean, it's not about cyberspace, but it's about unintentional consequences of, you know, important governmental decisions over a long period. So, you know, back in 2005, when the war on terror was hotter, obviously some Italian legislators thought it would be a good idea to register all the foreigners who want internet access in Italy. Well, yeah, you know, to some extent, probably that was doable. I mean, it's possible to build such a superstructure. I'm a foreigner in Italy. Every foreigner in Italy gets internet access, I mean, whether he's a terrorist or not. And, you know, really the strongest and most publicly visible result of this political decision is that people like your group here have to apologize to foreigners. I mean, this is like a little apology. It's like, I'm sorry, it's like this, you know? And it's like, it's just, you know, a set of weird humiliations, really. And, you know, there are aspects of Italian electronic policy which are brilliant. Like, I love topics. Topics or the internet exchange here in Piemonte, super dynamic guys. I mean, really, really an impressive bunch of characters. But, you know, by making a decision of this kind and then sort of sticking to it over a long period, you end up creating a society that has no public Wi-Fi. So that, and you sort of guarantee that once foreigners begin chatting on social networks about Italy, this will be the first thing they say to everybody in their social network. Boy, it was hard getting my semi-legal internet access. And they turn into a giant promotion machine to make Italy look old-fashioned. I mean, and including to William Gibson, by the way, who is on Twitter. William Gibson's on Twitter. He follows me. I've been hashtagging Communia. That, you know, that means William Gibson has been reading things going on in this room. It's not like a distant or remote thing. We're kind of all in each other's laps now. You know, how could I tell you this? Well, there's a difference between being deliberately old-fashioned and kind of accidentally old-fashioned. You know, and this policy is sort of accidentally old-fashioned, whereas to be deliberately old-fashioned, I think, has some real promise in terms of cyberspace. Because, you know, it is an old idea. I mean, it's 28 years old and predates the World Wide Web and many other things. I mean, cyberspace is almost 30 years old. It's not yesterday's idea. You know, and the university system is 900 years old, and every Italian knows that, you know, the modern university system started in Bologna and so forth and so on, and it's much older than nation states even, and, you know, the university system has tremendous, almost millennial heritage. It has a lot of things to be old-fashioned about. I mean, a lot of good, constructive, old-fashioned things. The internet first appeared in UCLA, University of California, Los Angeles. It was first built in a school. It wasn't built in the military, not commerce, not government. It was built in a school. Facebook, world's biggest social network today, for college students. It's a yearbook. It's a college yearbook that somehow got out of control and now has more people on it than most G7 nations. College students, mind you, not the faculty, not the chancellor, it's all about the students, Facebook. CERN is where World Wide Web was first invented, the CERN. I once met some guys at the CERN and CERN. They said, oh, if only, instead of using the letters HTTP, which mean nothing, basically, if only we'd used the letters CERN, we would have had, you know, an advertisement every time anybody ever used a web computer of any kind ever. And they were bitter about that fact that they had missed the chance to hook themselves to this explosive development. But I had to tell this poor guy that he can't even use his own name, because CERN, of course, means the Center for European Nuclear Research. The N is nuclear. And CERN is 60 years old. And if you go to CERN, you will see that they have methodically removed any mention of the word nuclear. There is no nuclear in the CERN. I mean, when they were first founded just after World War II, it was exciting and sexy to be nuclear, because it was the atomic age, and they were nuclear in much the way that you are cyberspace. They were nuclear, but then 60 years passed, and you really don't want to be nuclear in contemporary society. CERN people have to censor their own name, even though their scholarly question, which is, what is the ultimate nature of matter? That's their question. That question, that old-fashioned question, is as old as the ancient Greeks. It's their name, nuclear, that cannot last. It's this frame that can't last. It's this word, it's this paradigm that we're nuclear, that we're from the atomic age. They're still very interested in Higgs bosons. They really don't want to be nuclear, and they don't want to be atomic age, because the very thing that seemed futuristic when CERN was first created turned out to be old-fashioned and fairly short order. You know, and why is that? Well, it's because the atomic age was not an age. The atomic age just isn't an age. The atomic age is like a rather brief cultural period, maybe 20, 25 years. And really showing its age by the time it was 12 or 13 years old. And now not only old, but like repulsively old-fashioned. If you go around to somebody now and say, I am a citizen of the atomic age, you will get very strange looks from people. Even though we are citizens of the atomic age, I mean, we use nuclear power, we're building more nuclear power plants, we have nuclear weapons, we have the entire infrastructure of the atomic age, we don't have the mental framework of the atomic age. It just was not an age. And there is no network age. Reformatting institutions, you know, reshaping knowledge institutions for the network age, there is no network age. There is a network period, rather brief network period. And it's rather like CERN's atomic age, except probably briefer. It's like the automation age. It's like the jet age. It's like the supersonic age. It's probably about a network decade. Network decade. It's like the age of the information superhighway, the age of the dot-coms, the age of the mainframes, except it's really, really big. I mean, this particular innovation, what we now call networking and what used to be called cyberneticization or digitization or virtualization, any of a number of very rapidly aging terms, has penetrated every modern institution without exception. There were things that escaped automation. There were things that escaped electrification. There were many things that escaped becoming nuclear. Nothing, really, almost nothing that matters to anybody has escaped being networked. Even intimate things like the structure of the family, normally a private domain, sacrosanct, free from industrial intrusion. If you look at the common practice of modern families, people communicate mostly through, considerably through devices like this. This is the electronic vernacular of 21st century families. You talk to your wife, your husband, you track your children, you see if your grandmother needs help. It's all through devices like this. The intimacy of the family fireside has been disrupted by this. There's no particular reason for family members to stay together in this tribal way. Courtship has changed. People are finding their mates on the internet. There's an explosion of people marrying foreigners now. People always kind of want to marry foreigners. It's tactically difficult. Not anymore. You can get right in the lap of some foreign guy now. All you have to do is follow his life stream. You know what he eats, you know what his plates look like, you know what his house looks like. You can make friends with his dog. It doesn't matter if he's in Norway. The military has been transformed. Here it is. Everybody's military is being transformed. As soon as anybody, any military, claims that they have a aggressive cyberspace capacity, an electronic warfare strike capacity, an instant arms race breaks out. This is happening right now. It's happening all over the place. Generation of electronic warriors is being trained, 30,000 of them. That's just in the U.S. They're all over. Finance, of course. We could see what happened to electronic finance. A terrible story. Science, yes, the practice of citation is being turned on its head by electronics. Publishing papers, what does that mean in a world when there's no paper, when scientists read no paper? They cannot help it. It's a body blow at the root of that knowledge structure. Publishing, of course, we all know publishing is falling apart. Television, the news media generally, in a terrible state. News media violently disrupted by the internet. The number of journalists who've lost their jobs over the past few, unbelievable numbers. Newspapers shutting down all over the planet, very few starting. News channels going away. Channels are going away. There are no channels. Media is going away. There really is no media in the sense of like, I'm here and you're there and there's a medium. No, it's just the net. Or a space. Manufacturing is changing. Retail, of course, has changed. Advertising in a similarly perilous state. Religion has changed. We've got televangelism now, other forms of electronic religion. Diplomacy has changed. People don't need embassies. They could just connect directly to people in other countries. Why do they need this cutout, this medium of a diplomat and his little fortress in your country. Cinema has been changed, fine art has been changed, music has been dealt a blow from which it may never recover. Agriculture has changed, slow food, fast food, Monsanto. And of course the university is going to be affected by this. But I would urge you to look at what has happened to other institutions that have reshaped themselves for a networked age. It is not an entirely pretty story. By no means are these an unalloyed set of successes. Do we have better finance? Do we have more effective military? Do we have a more just legal system? Do we write better novels? Do we see better movies? Is our manufacturing cleaner and more efficient? Is our news media telling us the truth? Are our publishing enterprises flourishing? Are our diplomats bringing world peace? Is our food safe to eat? Are our families sounder? What is it that you are buying into here? And at least the history of electronic banking should give you serious pause. Electronic banking and the electronic university, reshaping finance for the networked age. You know, is that an unalloyed success? I mean, look what it has done to all these other people. Now, have any of them successfully resisted the intrusions of network capacity? The answer is no. There is no center of resistance to this dynamic. It has swept all before it. There isn't even a single coherent group with a good political, commercial, or ideological argument against it. They've all been swept aside. It's like trying to combat climate change. It's almost that overwhelming a change. It's a huge, overwhelming change. It's not really very much like a device. It's more like nationalism or a religion. It's like watching the Roman Empire get swept aside by Christianity. It's like watching the rise of nation states. As soon as you've got one nation state, everybody else wants to have a nation state. Some take their time about it, like Italy. But everybody ends up with a nation state because you sort of have to have one, or you're just not okay. That's what it's like. Now, it isn't because it was a bad idea any more than cyberspace is a bad idea. Cyberspace is, in fact, a pretty good science fictional idea. I remember the first time I looked at it, I thought, boy, that one's gonna get up and walk, This cyberspace idea is sexy and attractive. And it is a sexy and attractive idea. But if you read the original William Gibson works about cyberspace, you could see that his science fictional idea is about hallucinating. I mean, cyberspace is an experience inside people's heads. It's a hallucination, which is induced in people's brains by a brain-computer interface. That's a really good science fictional idea. It's got very little to do with the results here, okay? It just has very little to do with that. And if you had been a university guy back in 1982, and you had read this William Gibson story from 1982, you would have immediately become very involved in mind-computer interfaces, a technology which has basically gone nowhere in 30 years. And if you tried to reshape your knowledge institution for cyberspace when the word was first invented, you would have failed completely. You would be a laughingstock. It would be that bad. Now, and that's just the way of the world. I don't want to be upset about it or, to make this sound cynical. It was not a bad idea for William Gibson to write a brilliant science fiction story. I mean, we need more of those, not fewer of those. I'm just pointing out the long-term consequences of activities like this. Now, I'm not really the proper person to do that. Right now, there are basically four people doing that who I take seriously as writers. They are Nicholas Carr, C-A-R-R. He wrote the famous essay, "Is Google Making Us Stupid?" They are Andrew Keen, K-E-E-N, the Antichrist of Silicon Valley, as he is known. Jaron Lanier, L-A-N-I-E-R, one of the pioneers of virtual reality and now a critic of internet and creative policies on the internet. And Dmitry Morozov, who is a Belarusian dissident who has become an American diplomat and sort of international policy expert. So these guys are internet critics. They're internet cultural critics. Keen, Lanier, Carr, and Morozov. I'm not one of them. I pay attention to what they're doing. I don't agree with what they say, but time is on their side. Time is on the side of the critics because there will be a devastating reassessment of the network age. There's going to be a devastating reassessment of the network age in the same way that there were devastating reassessments of the jet age, or the atomic age, or the nuclear age. Now, there's been a lot of talk at your event about digital natives. And we have some people now who really have grown up within the internet and are probably something like digital natives. But I don't consider them true digital natives because they still have some childhood experience of an analog world. To my mind, the first true digital native is a guy who attacks digital society. He's going to be a critic who attacks digital society, not embracing it as current digital natives do, to sort of say, well, I'm digital and young, and you're old and analog. No, this is going to be a guy who's digital and young and romanticizes the old and the analog. He's going to compare it to his own world and treat his own world disfavorably. In other words, he's going to be an angry digital native who is upset at the shortcomings of digital society and compares it in detail to his idea of an idealized past. And he will valorize the idealized past. The first true digital native is going to be the guy who says the analog people were more civilized than us. Back in the old days when they had black and white TV, when they had real newspapers, when they were capable, focused people in hierarchies, those were the good old days. And we need to recapture the virtues of that lost time, of our great grandparents. And clearly, I can promise you this, this guy, this digital native, will have no idea what he is talking about. He will never have seen those 20th century things. They will appear to him in a misty historical haze. He will valorize them. He will romanticize them because they are dead and because he can use them as a rhetorical whip against his peers. And he will be right. He will be right because his society, his network, ridden society will need a great deal of reform. And to go back to an analog situation and to use historical parallels is a good way to reform a society. I am waiting for that guy. I'm not him. I know he's coming. Could well be a woman. I'm waiting for her. I'm waiting for her entire feminist consciousness raising group. I'm willing to go. I'm waiting for him. I want to help him. I want to help him. What will he say? He will say that his world is emergent, that it's networked, that it is like a slum, that it is ruled by mobs, that it is weak, that it is crumbling, that it is obsessed with short-term returns. He will say that his world is like a favela, that it's something perched on the remnants of a dead city. He will say that his world is like an unplanned suburb. He will say that it's like a gold rush town. He will take all the things that Joey Ito properly told us were virtues, the lightweight construction, the layers, the immunity system, try it first, throw it out there, fail early, fail often, the things that are genuine philosophies of internet development, really effective, cheap, fast ways to build a network society, the things we've created that work, those are the things he will attack because of their long-term consequences. Now, and what does this sound like? Well, it's really going to sting. It's really going to hurt your feelings. It's going to really hurt your feelings. It would be as if you were Turinese and you had built cars for 100 years and an environmentalist came up to give you a good scolding. Not that you were bad at making cars, that you were too good at making cars. Way too good at making cars. You were the capital of car making in Italy, the industrial capital of Italy, the automotive boom town of Italy. You were at it for 100 years. 100 years, the capital of traffic jams, the capital of automobile fatalities, the capital of destroying the planet's atmosphere, the capital of mass extinction, the capital of fossil fuels, the capital of oil war. That's what it's going to sound like. Because, you know, the judgment of history is merciless. So you may ask, since I know this can happen, and I know it can be said, why am I so fond of Torino? I mean, why am I in Torino? It's because I know people in Detroit. I know a lot of people in Detroit. There has never been a collapse of a city in North America like the collapse of Detroit. Not since the downfall of the Mayas and the Aztecs has a city in North America fallen so far, so fast, and done so little to save itself. I go to Torino in order to learn. I come to Torino in order to learn, and boy, in Torino, I learn something new every day. The long-term consequences. The long-term consequences are waiting. When it comes to educating students, and you know, this is an academic audience, I mean, what would you do with your students if you thought about them in the long term? I mean, you know, I mean, what kind of philosophy would that be? Well, you know, I urge you to think about this. I mean, ask yourself the question, what kind of people will run the world when you are 80 years old? I mean, you'll be 80 years old in, I don't know, 30 years or something. It's not that far away. It's no farther away than the word cyberspace. I mean, word cyberspace is 30 years old, and another 30 years old, you'll be 80, and you'll be old. You'll be old and feeble and blind and weak, and the world will be in command of your students. And what habits of thought and action do you wish they had? Well, teach them now. Teach them that stuff now. I mean, teach them to run the world when you're 80. I mean, teach them now when you can be of some use to them. Because when you're 80, you're not going to be of very much use. Would you say, I really wish they had the most up-to-date Apple iPhone? I really wish I had the most up-to-date Apple iPhone. People in our society really, really, really want the most up-to-date Apple iPhone. They will arrive at 3 a.m. and stand in long queues to have the most up-to-date Apple iPhone. Obviously, this is a thing that is deeply valorized by our society. It means almost as much to us as sex or money. Why don't you give them an Apple IIe? Because that's what a 30-year-old Apple iPhone looks like. It looks like an Apple IIe. And if you saw an Apple IIe, I mean, if there was an Apple IIe right here, with its floppy disk drives and its green phosphor 80-line monitor, would you pick it up? Would you bend over and take it home? Would it be of any value to you whatsoever? Of any value? Of any conceivable value? Would you want it in your home? Would you show it to a child or a friend? Would you give it to a friend, hoping that they would want to have it? Okay, well, that's an Apple iPhone when you're 80. That's it. That's what it is. What do colleges really do for young people? I mean, what is the purpose of a young person going to university? My feeling is it's all about the spirit of a generation. It's not really about what the professors tell them. I mean, there's some of that. They're required to pay attention. They're graded. It's really about what members of a generation tell one another. It's the student body that's the important part of the university. That's the body. I mean, that's the heart and the skin and the organs are the students. It's a chance for them to think for themselves about basic issues of our civilization. They don't have to earn a living. They're young, they're bright, they're inventive. They're seeking their own identity. They're trying to establish an adult role in the world. They're trying to find out what it is they want to do with the rest of their lives. It's a chance to get married, which is very common in universities. You can't get any of that without the other students. None of that can be electronically transmitted. It doesn't really work. And it's also, universities are machines for freeing people's parents. It's about the parents and getting an 18-year-old time bomb out of the house. That's the unspoken service of universities. It's certainly the unspoken service of K-12, kindergarten through 12th grade, is about freeing the productive capacity of the parents. It's about moving the children into creches. It doesn't really matter that much whether they learn anything in the school or not. The parents have to go to work. They have to generate wealth for the rest of the society. Universities act as a method of reducing intergenerational conflict and allowing a new generation to find its own zeitgeist. If you remove this capacity, which has very little to do with cyberspace, our society is going to find some real turbulence. It's not about learning or teaching. That's a vocational school. Vocational schools are about learning and teaching. Industrial schools, employee training is about learning and teaching. That's not a university. Universities have never been about that for 900 years. These are values that I think are deliberately old-fashioned values that you ought to be espousing and building up. They're values that can outlast the network, period, as it is. It's about passing the torch of civilization to the coming generation. That's a difficult matter. And it's not something that we've ever codified, and it's not something we can really do effectively through software. So I go to school, and I've been to a university. But I don't really go to a university now, because even though I do learn something new every day in Torino, I'm not a young person. I don't have a lifetime to put my learnings into practice. When I go to school, and I frequently do go to schools, I have to teach. And what do I teach? Well, it's always futurism. That's always what comes next. And the long term, when I can teach it. And what comes next for the network era, the network period? A lot. Not a little bit, a lot. We are almost exactly like people in 1910. In 2010, we're very, very similar to our spiritual ancestors in 1910, talking about electricity and aviation and mass production and cars. And people in 1910 were very aware of electricity, aviation, mass production, and cars. They knew all about it. It was all over the newspapers. Aviators were famous, car makers were famous, electricity was highly valorized, it was being spread all over, mass production was starting, people knew that factories, new methods of production were exploding. They were as knowledgeable as you about these change drivers within their own society. Their ability to understand the world when they were 80, to forecast the world of the 1940s and 1910? not real, real likely. I mean, many of the models you've invented for trying to understand network society are going to be abandoned. Some have already been abandoned. They're dead. They're gothic. I would urge you to forget more of them. Forget the bricks and clicks model. It's like, I've got some bricks over here and I have some clicks over here. The virtual and the actual dichotomy, real space and cyberspace, real world, simulated world, offline world, online world, print world, electronic publication world. These divisions are a period artifact. They mean very little to a digital native. They are going away. You're seeing integrated, hybridized, augmented, pervasive, physicalized, informaticized versions of these things, embedded versions of these things. That's like a scholastic distinction. It's not going to hold. We're going into a world that's more like ice, water, and steam. It's not sort of real or actual. There's the actual real and the real actual and the realized actual and the fabricated realized actual. These distinctions aren't really going to help us understand what's happening. I mean, what's the grand trend? Well, maybe I can help. Consider these words, I mean, these paradigms for your network age. The mainframe, the desktop, the information superhighway, the net, the web, the cloud. The mainframe, the desktop, the highway, the net, the web, the cloud. What do those metaphors suggest when you line them up? It's an ever finer mesh. I mean, the mainframe is often a box. And then the desktop is in the home, and there's more of them. And the highway connects them, and it's a channel and a medium. And then the net is reticulated. It's laid on top and divides the world up into a grid. And then the web grows spider-like. It's permeating everywhere. It's thin. It's sticky. You can't get away from it. And the cloud is like a mist. It's wireless. It's pervasive. It's everywhere. It's in your pockets. It's in your hat. It's on your ear Bluetooth. It's embedded in objects. What comes after that? We don't really have a word for it. The augmented, always-on, locative reality. Something along that line. I mean, nobody's really coined the term for what comes after the cloud. We're still struggling to describe what the cloud really is. There's the Amazon cloud, the Microsoft cloud, the wireless WiMAX urban cloud, the urban informatic cloud. Clearly, this is coming. We don't know what's coming next. I can promise you that when what comes next does come next, they're going to say, we're just getting started. They're going to say, we're just getting started. It's the knowledge institution restarting itself for the world of the always-on, plugged-in, locative reality world. It's like, yes, I'm an always-on, plugged-in, locative reality native because I've never been without my three-dimensional augmented device, and I think we need to recast everything in order to understand this. There will be ideologues saying that. I can guarantee that. The meshes get finer and finer. And I don't think we're going to be able to stop that. We've invested a great deal of money in doing it. There are Moore's Law style imperatives that make this line of development very clear. There's really very little that anybody in this room can do to shape that dynamic. It is loose upon the landscape. It is part of our techno-social condition. It's what is happening. But I want to point something out to you in this list of metaphors. The old metaphors die. They don't live for ages. They die. Nobody cares about mainframe or information superhighway. If you go to your chancellor and say, we want to reshape our knowledge institution for the information superhighway, you will lose all your funding. You will be treated as a lunatic. You will be shown the door.
The old metaphors die, and the information superhighway is not that old. I mean, Al Gore, who coined that term, is still, you know, a functional political figure. He even has sex scandals. You know, that's how young and vital Al Gore is. It's the idea that's dead. And you're going to outlive many of these ideas. Many. The network gets reshaped much faster than the knowledge institution can be reshaped. You can't reshape a 900-year-old institution at the speed that these networks reshape themselves. And they die. You don't want to die. Now, the cyberspace metaphor, 30 years old, you can see how violently reshaped that has become. This is contemporary cyberspace. It's not bad that these things happen, but you need to understand that these historical formulations are mortal. They're not false. It's not like the information superhighway never existed. It existed. It got federal funding. There are political things, newspaper stories. It's not false. It's just mortal. And you don't want to tie your fate to mortal things. Now, universities need to be places in our society where young people who know very little, young, innocent, ignorant people, are put directly in touch with things that are less mortal than we are. Less mortal than we are. Not more mortal than we are. You need to be put in touch with things less mortal, that will live longer. If it's something that's more mortal than a student, more mortal than the institution, that is like, it's like the pigeon on the head of the statue. It's like the pigeon on the head of the statue. You know, and a pigeon can fly. I like pigeons. People feed them. I mean, this is a pigeon, you know. This is a pigeon, and this is a pigeon. Because they're kind of mobile, and they live about as long as a pigeon. Pigeon lasts about 3 years. These two devices in 3 years, they're kind of dead like pigeons. You don't want to put the statue on the head of the pigeon. You can put the pigeon on the head of the statue. Don't build the statue on the head of the pigeon. The pigeon can't carry it. The internet is going to die. The idea of the internet, the historical formulation of the internet, it's going to die from its own success. Not because it failed or that it failed to function, because it won and buried itself within the texture of society. And much the way that Gibsonian cyberspace is buried inside its new espionage military formulation. It will vanish into daily life, and if you walk around 50 years from now saying, where's your internet? It's going to be like saying, where's your electrical power plant? It's just, why would I care? It's sort of here, it's always on. The internet will die. The data will die that's on the internet if it's not well looked after. We have no archival medium for ones and zeros. We have no archival medium. There is not one single storage method for ones and zeros that we know will last 50 years. Just 50 years, which is nothing. I mean, a genuine archival medium ought to last 200 years, maybe 400 years, if it's kept away from humidity and light in a dry space. We have no such medium. We are destroying them faster than we're building them. We think that because we have huge amounts of storage, we have permanent amounts of storage. That is not true. You can talk to people in libraries about this. You could talk to people in the Library of Congress. We have migration strategies for data. We don't have a place to put it and leave it alone. All we have are institutional policies that say every 5 years we try to drag everything off the university's servers and move it onto another frame. And there's like a horde of displaced refugees. That's not a good way to treat data. That's certainly not the way scholars should treat data. And yet you're mortgaging your future to a method of data transfer with has no archives. There isn't even a group of people in a capacity to build the archives, you know, and the difficulties there go way, way down. It's like ignoring Vesuvius. It's like we've moved from northern Italy into southern Italy. I mean, that's what the transition from the virtual to the actual, from the actual to the virtual, is really like. It's like moving from the flat, fertile plains of Padania to the flanks of Vesuvius. And there's not just one earthquake, okay? It's not like there was the old actual world, and then there was an earthquake, and then we like built the new digital world. No, when you live in the new digital world, you live on the flanks of Vesuvius. There's an earthquake, and then there's another earthquake, and then there's an eruption, and then there's another eruption. And then the town gets knocked down, and it gets covered with lava, and everybody rebuilds it, and then it gets knocked down again. There's no end state where you have reshaped your institution, and it's now safe because the land is safe. The land is inherently unsafe. And it's because of our virtues, not because of our lack. That's because of Joey Ito's very eloquent description of how we effectively build such things. That is how we effectively build such things. Favela style, small pieces loosely joined, that's a favela. Fail early, fail often, that's a favela. Distributed working groups on the Wikipedia, those are favelas. Institutions with three-year funding so that they can like have some good ideas about something and then go away, that's a favela. It's not really a knowledge institution. That's a circus tent. And we did it, and we're going to have to pay a long-term price for that. That's all right. History passes. It's all part of the grand parade. This is the world in which we live. I just think scholars need to understand this world. So let me conclude by telling you a science fiction parable, like a science fiction style parable. And just imagine that you are the chancellor of the University of Pompeii. And oh, Pompeii, 100 AD. It's this really nice resort town. It's on the sea. And a lot of rich people have nice resort things there. It's, you know, it's an Italian resort town. So it's full of pretty girls and rich guys and, you know, oranges and wine. And there's tourists and, you know, there's a very nice sports stadium where people get killed. And, you know, and you're the chancellor and you have a lot of students. Now, luckily, you're a very wise man. I mean, you really have unusual insight and strategic wisdom for a chancellor. So what are you going to do knowing that Vesuvius is going to erupt and a red-hot cloud of volcanic ash is going to sweep down and bury the entire town? I mean, you know this is going to happen. You don't know exactly how it's going to happen. It's just sort of obvious because you know what volcanoes are. I mean, you don't ignore the volcano. You're aware that it's a volcano. Okay, well, what could you do? Well, you have some various options. Option number one, just run. Just run away. I mean, panic. Lose your head about it. It's the worst. Why did I ever build near this volcano? My heart is beating in terror. I can't sleep at night. The risk, the fear. You know, I'm overwhelmed. I mean, it's just the doom. You can walk away with a doomsday stick and just flee. And flee wherever you think you might find some safety from the volcano. Step B, another possibility, plug the volcano. You need a technical solution for this. The volcano is going to erupt. Maybe you should do something muscular about the volcano, like go drill things in the side and hope that the lava pours out. You might make the volcano illegal. You could go to Rome. I don't like volcanoes. They should be put under a curse. You know, they should throw maidens into the volcano. Step C, well, this is option number C, make a whole lot of copies of stuff.
just copy the canon. I mean, the stuff that you've been trying to transfer, find some other way to, like, see to it that it doesn't get destroyed. Make a lot of copies of it and kind of distribute them widely to the extent that you can. Kind of the public domain solution. Just kind of move this imperiled stuff away from your university and sort of get it into another system distribution so it won't be lost. Bury the valuable stuff. Bury some of it where you know the volcano is going to hit. I mean, bury it really deeply. Because actually a lot of our knowledge of the ancient world comes out of stuff that was seemingly abandoned in Pompeii. You know, had a chancellor done that, if he'd just taken the things that a normal, educated young Roman would have known, the poems of Sappho, all the comedies of Terence, the various other works of Aristotle besides the Ethics, any number of Platonic dialogues, theatrical things, boring technical documents from Alexandria about how to build steam engines, things that were common knowledge of the period, you know, just the canon of an educated person. If he had put those things in a fireproof safe and buried them in Pompeii, he'd be the most famous man in the world. I mean, we would bless that guy 1,000 times over for behavior that seemed senseless. If he'd just given it to us, his remote descendants, things of seemingly little value to him, but tremendous value to us, that were lost by transformations of time. The device, the service, the network, and the code. These are all very valuable things. I pay a great deal of attention to them. I think in the university, you have to ask yourself about these network services. Do they help me network the dead with the unborn? Not do they network with my clients, do they network with industry, do I like get to form multidisciplinary groups with Brussels? Do they help me network the dead with the unborn? That should be your version of a network society. That's your network society, the network between the dead and the unborn. I mean, to be contemporary, to be aware of what's happening in your time and your own space is a necessity. To be temporary is bad. To be contemporary, that's fine. It's praiseworthy. It's useful. You need a deeper understanding as scholars of what's happening in real time. To be temporary and to mortgage your future to temporary things, that's not wise. Network the dead with the unborn. If you can make that work, the future will bless you for it. Thank you for your attention. Yeah. Words of wisdom. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Direttamente, sì.